Okay, dear students, today I will teach you about one important concept that is moving coil ballistic galvanometer. Moving coil ballistic galvanometer I supposed to teach. Okay, first idea, moving coil ballistic galvanometer means BG, ballistic galvanometer. First concept, what is the principle adopted here? What principle that we are using in the case of ballistic galvanometer? If you are keeping a coil here, this is a coil. If you are keeping this coil in which the current, if it is flowing, let us imagine the current is flowing like this. This amount of current that is flows through the coil. Of course, here also like this. If it is kept in a uniform magnetic field, let me consider it is a uniform magnetic field that we have kept. This current carrying coil placed in a uniform magnetic field, let me consider I is the current that is flowing here. Then this side and this side experiences a maximum amount of force. Of course, the direction is given by the Fleming's left hand rule here. The forefinger representing the direction of the magnetic field and the middle finger representing the direction of the current. The thumb representing the direction of the force. Therefore, this force is acting like this. This force is acting like this. Due to these two equal and opposite forces, in PUC level already we are already understood about this BIL sin theta, where L is the length of the conductor, B is the magnetic field, I is the current. Here small I is the current here, therefore I will write small I. If one turn is present, one number of turn is present, 1 into BIL. If 10 turns are there, 10 into BIL. If it is having n number of turns, it is NBIL. This is also NBIL. So many newtons of force that is acting. Due to this one, the two forces are acting at a perpendicular distance between here to here is equal to B here. Therefore, it is acted by a torque. This is the principle adopted here. What is that? When a current flows through a coil, which is placed in a uniform magnetic field, experiences a force here now on the two sides. Because of these two forces are acting on the two sides of the conductor, equal force acting in opposite direction, which constitutes a couple, which constitutes a torque, which experiences a torque. Due to that one, coil is going to begin deflecting here. And the direction of this force is given by Fleming's left hand rule. This is the concept. Now the next one, construction. Okay, a little bit quickly, let us finish it off this idea. Okay, what is that? Next concept, construction. Okay, I said already, there is a coil is present here like this. This is a coil. It is having L is the length of the coil, B is the breadth of the coil. Length into breadth is equal to area of the coil. Length of the coil, breadth of the coil, L length, B breadth, which is placed or it is hanged, it is suspended by means of a phosphor bronze wire, which is a specially made wire. It is a phosphor bronze wire. It is a non-metallic frame on which we have wound so many number of tons of fine insulated thin copper wire. Then afterwards it has been connected to a very fragile material, sensitive material called by the name the phosphor bronze wire. It has been connected, and then we are connected to a small mirror here represented by M. It is a small concave circular light mirror. Concave circular light mirror. When the light energy is incidenting here, it is going to get focusing on the scale. Okay, lamp and scale arrangement that is. Then it has been connected to torsion head here. It has been connected to the TH torsion head. Okay, this is a torsion head. Here there is a knob is present here. We can rotate the knob practically. Okay, to align this coil here. And this coil, this lower end is connected to a spring. It is also usually made up of a phosphor bronze spring, because it is more active and more sensitive spring we are using to restore the original position of the coil. Coil, if it is deflecting, it has to return back to original position. Then it is connected to the two terminals, one is T1, the other one is T2, to pass the current or the charge. Here to here we are connecting using a copper wire. This coil, it has been placed between the two concave pole pieces of a horseshoe magnet. This is south and this is north. So here to here there is a radial magnetic field that is acting. Radial magnetic field, it is said to be a larger amount of magnetic field, strengthy magnetic field. And inside here we are going to keep one small cylinder also. That cylinder produces more amount of the magnetic flux, more amount of magnetic flux. Okay, the cylinder produces more amount of magnetic flux. It is an iron cylinder, usually. Okay, this is construction work, that is. This is a horseshoe magnet. Concave structure, pole pieces are having the concave in nature here because we want to get a radial magnetic field to the plane of the coil. To the radial magnetic field, it is always acting along maybe it is theta is equal to 90 degrees. It is always, for that purpose we are using the concave structure. Okay, this is the concept here. Now because of this magnetic field, whatever it is acting here, the sides of these two coil is acted by the two forces. The two forces are said to be F is equal to NBIL, where N is the number of turns, B is the magnetic field, I is the strength of the current, L is the length of the coil. B is the breadth, of course. B is the breadth of the coil. Length into breadth is equal to area of the coil. Okay. Due to these two forces, the coil is going to get deflected. It's called by the name, that is that idea, that concept. That concept is called by the name here. Angular momentum, torque. It produces a torque. I suppose to write the torque value here now. So torque is given by how much? Okay, torque is equal to how much? I suppose to write torque is equal to one of the forces. Out of the two forces, we have to select one of the forces according to our first PUC, multiplied by the perpendicular distance. So the torque is equal to one of the forces, whatever it is acting, is said to be, I said already, NBIL multiplied by the perpendicular distance between the two. The perpendicular distance between the two forces, between this force to this force here, the perpendicular distance is equal to breadth of the coil. So therefore, I will write the breadth of the coil here now, that is B. But L into B is said to be the area. NBIA that I can write. Okay, this is torque. Now, for small time, let us consider for a small time dt, the angular impulse is equal to how much? Angular impulse in the coil is equal to tau into dt. Tau multiplied by dt. That is also equal to here, NBIA multiplied by dt. Okay, for a long time interval, for a time of t seconds, if I'm considering, then angular impulse is equal to how much? Total angular impulse. Okay, the total angular impulse in the coil is equal to here, integration of 0 to t tau dt. Here also, that is NBA is a constant, integration of 0 to t I dt I will write, right hand side also. So therefore, this integration of this one is equal to here, that is equal to here, NBA, this integration of I dt is equal to Q, charge taken from your second PUC. So integration of I dt is equal to Q, 0 to t. Okay, this is taken from your first PUC. Charge is equal to, current is equal to how much? Charge divided by time. Okay, therefore charge is equal to current into time. Charge is equal to current into time. This is a charge whatever it is passing. Okay, this is one concept here now. So therefore, the whatever the angular impulse is said to be acting is equal to this much. Also, the angular momentum of the coil is given by angular momentum in the coil is given by I into omega, where I is the moment of inertia, omega is the angular velocity of the coil. I is the moment of inertia of the coil, omega is the angular velocity of the coil. This is also NBAQ, that is angular impulse. I omega is also angular momentum. So therefore I will equate these two now. If I am equating these two here, I can write I omega is equal to NBA into Q. I will take this one as maybe some equation that I can choose. No problem. Right? Otherwise, you keep it as it is. That's okay. So, this is angular impulse of the coil. This is also angular impulse of the coil in terms of moment of inertia and angular velocity of the coil. Omega is the angular velocity of the coil. I is the moment of inertia of the coil. Now, kinetic energy of the coil is equal to how much? Kinetic energy of the movement, because the coil is rotating now, the kinetic energy of that one is equal to half into I into omega square. It is not W, it is omega square, kinetic energy. Work done is equal to how much? Work done itself is called by the name the kinetic energy, don't forget, taken from first PUC again. Kinetic energy of the coil is half I omega square. Again, I is moment of inertia, omega is angular velocity, half I omega square. And work done of the coil is given by, of course, work done by the coil because it is twisting. The wire is twisting like this now. Because of that one, there is a work done. The work done is given by half C theta square, where theta is the angle of deflection or angle of twisting, we can say. C is the restoring couple, restoring torque per unit twist, where C is called by the name the restoring torque per unit twist. Restoring torque per unit twist. Theta is the angle of twisting in the suspension wire. The phosphor bronze wire is there now, that is going to get twisted, that value. Now I will equate these two now, because work done itself is called by the name the kinetic. It is a type of kinetic energy. Whenever if we are defining kinetic energy, we are defining that is a work done only. The work done itself is called by the name the kinetic energy, we are going to say. Therefore these two are equal to each other. Therefore, I can equate these two here. Half I omega square is equal to half C theta square. Okay. Followed this idea, you see that. So, therefore, I omega, half get cancelled here. I omega square is equal to C theta square. Clear? Up to here, have I understood? So I omega square is equal to C theta square. I will block this one now. This is one concept, this is another concept. I omega square is equal to C theta square. Now, since the coil is rotating like this and oscillating like this now, since the coil is oscillating, it is having a period of oscillation. That period of oscillation I suppose to write here. The period of oscillation T is equal to how much? T is equal to 2 pi into square root of I divided by C, where I is the moment of inertia, C is what is that? The couple, whatever it is acting, unit twist, restoring torque per unit twist, that is called by the name the C, 2 pi square root of I divided by C. Now here, T squared, squaring on both the sides, you are going to have 4 pi square I divided by C. Therefore, I is equal to how much? Using this, I is equal to T square C divided by 4 pi square. Right? This is one more equation. Now, already we got the answer for I omega square. Correct? Now, I omega square, we know this already, is equal to C theta square. I will show it. I omega square is equal to C theta square. Okay, I will keep it as it is. Now, I will multiply this I on both the sides of this. Here and here, I will going to multiply. I multiplied by this, this multiplied by this. Therefore, this becomes I into I is I square omega square. Here, this one and this one we are supposed to multiply here. T square divided by 4 pi square. C into C is C square. This is theta square. Take out the square root here. you take out the square root. Therefore, I omega is equal to Tc theta divided by 2 pi, after taking the square root. Therefore, I omega is equal to this much. Is it right? Now, I omega, already we got one more answer now. But I omega is equal to NBA cube. But I omega is equal to NBA cube. Equate this and this. Therefore, this value is given by NBA cube is equal to Tc theta divided by 2 pi. I want to calculate Q because using the ballistic galvanometer, I supposed to measure how much is the charge that is flowing. Therefore, Q is equal to here T divided by 2 pi C divided by NBA, because they are all constants. Therefore, I am writing like that. C is a constant, NBA is a constant, multiplied by theta. This is the formula. Derivation is completed, but if they are asking damping correction also, we have to proceed further. We have to proceed further about the damping correction. That is the next concept. Okay, damping correction also I supposed to teach. I will teach it now itself. What is damping correction? Meaning, when the coil is revolving, when the coil is deflecting like this, or oscillating like this, when the coil is oscillating like this, because of the two forces, whatever the two forces are acting in the opposite direction, the coil is deflecting like this and oscillating. This oscillation is not equal to that of theta angle. It will be lesser than this theta, because there is an air resistance is present. When the coil is rotating, when the coil is oscillating like this, there is an air resistance. Not only that, inside this coil, there is an induced current. So therefore, due to the induced current and the air resistance, the theta we cannot measure correctly. Whatever we are measuring, the theta value is lesser than this original theta value. It will be lesser than this theta value. The correction term also that we are supposed to write, that is called by the name the damping correction. That also I will teach you carefully. You see that. Afterwards I will show the whole notes, everything I will show it. You can write afterwards. So what is that damping correction? Using the damping correction, determine the value of Q we are asking. So the meaning, this is theta. Or this is, I mean, sorry, this is the zero point of the scale. This is actual theta. It has to measure theta. But we are going to measure this one as theta 1. This is theta 1 is lesser than theta. Okay. Then it will oscillate like this. It will oscillate like this. Then oscillation that takes place here also. This is theta 2. It will come to this line. Theta 2. Then it will go here. Theta 3. Like this. Then it will go here. Theta 4. Then it will go this side, theta 5. Then it will go like this. This is called by the name the damping oscillation. Means the oscillation will be coming slower and slower and slower and slower. It is coming to rest. This is damped oscillation. This damping is said to be existing because of air resistance and the current, whatever it is inducing inside the current, because there is a change in the magnetic flux linking with the coil. Due to the change in the magnetic flux linking with the coil, there is an induced current. Due to that induced current, there is one more magnetic field is producing. Due to that action of that magnetic field and induced current, the coil deflection is go on decreasing. Okay. So theta 1, theta 2, already we have understood about that one. It is a deflection along both the sides of this O point. Means midpoint of the scale. Now I will go and consider theta 1 divided by theta 2. Theta 1 divided by theta 2 is equal to theta 2 divided by theta 3. That is equal to theta 3 divided by theta 4 is equal to a constant. That is called by the name D here. This is called by the name the decrement. This is called by the name the decrement for half. Decrement for half only. If it is going from here to here, theta 1 to theta 2. Half only. It is coming from here to here. Half. If it is coming from here to here and coming like this now, it is 1. It is half vibration. If it is going like this and coming like this, it is a 1 vibration. This is for half of the vibration. For half vibration. Now let us consider D is equal to e to the power lambda. Take the logarithm on both the sides. Okay, taking logarithm on both the sides. So therefore, log to the base e d is equal to here lambda log e to the base e. This is equal to 1. Therefore, lambda is equal to log d to the base e. This is called by the name the logarithmic decrement. This is called by the name the logarithmic decrement. Okay. Now, we are going to have the complete vibration here. If you want to get the complete vibration, theta 1 to theta 2, half vibration. Theta 1 to theta 2, again theta 3 if it is coming, it is complete vibration. For one complete vibration, for complete vibration, if I want to write, I can write theta 1 to theta 3. That can be written as theta 1 to theta 2, theta 2 to theta 3. This value is d, this value is d. Therefore, you are going to get d square. D square means, according to this idea, e to the power 2 lambda. Okay? Now, for the first throw here, for the first throw, theta is always, I said already, theta is always greater than theta 1. Theta is always greater than theta 1. This is whatever we have observed value. This is actual value. Observed value, this is actual value. Okay. Actual value is lesser than the, this is the true value. The true value is always greater. And observed value or practical value is always lesser because of air resistance and the induced current. Therefore, here, theta divided by theta 1, if I want to write. Theta divided by theta 1. Theta divided by theta 1 is equal to e to the power lambda by 2. This is lambda. This is lambda divided by 2. Here to here only. E to the power lambda by 2. But this value is equal to 1 plus lambda by 2 according to Taylor's theorem. If you want me to teach Taylor's theorem, I will write here. According to the Taylor's theorem, it says that e to the power x is equal to 1 plus x divided by 1 factorial plus x square divided by 2 factorial, x cube divided by 3 factorial, etc., etc. Higher order terms I will go into neglect. So therefore, e to the power x is equal to 1 plus x. Therefore, e to the power lambda by 2 is equal to 1 plus lambda by 2. Okay. Follow this. 1 plus lambda by 2. Therefore, I can substitute for 11 number of throws here. Theta 1 to theta 11, if you want to take, I can write like this. Theta 1 divided by theta 11 is equal to theta 1 by theta 2. Theta 2 by theta 3, theta 3 by theta 4, like this. If you are go on writing, you are going to have theta 10 divided by theta 11. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 you will get. So that is equal to d to the power 10, that is equal to e to the power 10 lambda. 10 lambda this is. Therefore, theta 1 divided by theta 11 is equal to e to the power 10 lambda. Take the logarithm on both the sides. Therefore, 10 lambda log to the base e is equal to log theta 1 divided by theta 11 to the base e. Log e to the base e is equal to 1. Therefore, 10 lambda is equal to, convert this log to the base e system to the base 10 system by a conversion factor 2.303. log to the base 10, theta 1 divided by theta 11. Therefore, lambda is equal to 2.303. This 10 coming to the denominator. Log to the base 10, theta 1 divided by theta 11. Therefore, lambda we have found out now. Go back to the original the theory. What is that original theory? Where it has been written? You have to see that. Okay, this is Q. Q is the known thing now. That Q value I will going to consider here. Because theta is equal to, already we know that theta is equal to something. Okay, theta plus written somewhere else. You see that. Here. Theta divided by theta 1 is equal to this. Theta is equal to theta 1 into this. Right. This one. Theta is equal to theta 1 multiplied by 1 plus lambda by 2. Therefore, wherever theta is coming up here, wherever theta is there, I suppose to substitute that value. Okay, that is theta 1. This value it has to be substituted. Okay, therefore, Q value is given by here. Q value is given by, this is using, without using damping correction, with using damping correction, NBA theta. Theta is equal to now theta 1 observed value. Okay, this is theoretical value, this is a practical value into 1 plus lambda by 2. This is using damping correction, this is without damping correction. So both I will show it again, just to see that time is very short, just to go through it. Okay, understand, one of the important question for your final exam. These are the notes that you are supposed to write at the time of examination. Okay, first principle, the whole notes that I am showing. Okay. First I am showing principle of the moving coil galvanometer or ballistic galvanometer. Then construction theory. Then damping correction. You can take the screenshots also. Construction. Construction work, continuation. This is a theory. Give the theory of moving coil galvanometer. Give the theory of ballistic moving coil galvanometer. If you start from here, enough. Theory only you can write. For maybe 7 marks or 8 marks. Without damping correction, if they are asking, they will ask for about 5 marks. With damping correction means they will ask for about 8 marks. Very easy. Don't leave the questions. This is the theory. theory of ballistic galvanometer. Charge sensitivity, we are asking for 2 marks, and the current sensitivity also we are asking for 2 marks. Voltage sensitivity is not present in your syllabus. I have not yet explained that one, but both are important for 2 marks question. Define charge sensitivity of a ballistic galvanometer or moving coil galvanometer. Define now. Charge sensitivity and current sensitivity. Write the relation between charge sensitivity and current sensitivity also. That also we can ask. Okay, this is the relation without damping correction. Without any damping correction, this is the answer. Derivation.